Likewise, thank you to the organizers for inviting me to come here and get to interact with many colleagues in the field and outside of the field. So a bit in the spirit of the nano-MRI and spin mechanics being joined together, I figured in my talk I would also discuss in part one a little bit about nanoscale magnetic and conductivity imaging, as Vincent very nicely introduced. And in the second part of my talk, I'll talk about prospects for hybrid spin mechanical systems in the quantum regime, introduced nicely yesterday by Peter Robel. And both of these experiments are done with NV centers and Diamond, sort of a testament to the versatility of the NV center, both in its sort of imaging modalities, as we've just heard, but also in its utility for sensing and also, say, as an element of a quantum network because of the, say, nonlinearity of a two-level system. So before I get into the work, just wanted to first make sure to thank my group, who is at UC Santa Barbara, and has really done all the work, and beautiful like here, but in a different way. Okay, so as I mentioned, there'll be two parts of the talk, and in the first, we'll utilize this platform that Vincent just introduced with an NV center at the apex of a scanning single crystal diamond probe to coherently image static magnetic fields arising from sort of magnetic textures and superconducting vortices. And then the second part, I will expand on the sort of relaxation imaging that Vincent also mentioned, to show that one can use the NV center in an imaging way to image electrical conductivity in a sample with very high spatial resolution. And in the second part, we'll talk about some progress towards entering the quantum regime with spin phonon photon hybrid systems, in which one confines spins and phonons and photons all into one nanoscale device for eventual applications in, say, quantum networks. Okay, so we've just heard about this. NV centers in a single spin microscope are a powerful tool to image condensed matter systems, and they have many important assets, that of variable temperature operation, something that I will highlight in our work, and being able to go down to 5 Kelvin, and I think Patrick will talk about next as well. Their simple optical readout makes them also a nice to use tool. Their single spin nature makes them minimally invasive and giving them some advantage over more invasive sensors like MFM, as Vincent discussed. And also their quantum properties give them high sensitivity, and their small size gives them high spatial resolution. So for all these reasons, I think NV centers really fill a unique niche for imaging of condensed matter systems. We've heard about some of the proposals and also some of the experimental work going on. So some systems of interest to image with NV centers in the community and also ongoing in our lab are those of nanoscale magnetic spin textures, such as skirmions, also as discussed by Vincent, in addition to looking at magnetic field distributions produced by magnetic spin textures, one can also image current flow patterns via the magnetic fields that they produce. And so one possible application for NV center magnetometry is imaging the current flow patterns, in particular non-trivial ones, and I think a very interesting system that's been discussed a lot recently in to observe hydrodynamic type flow effects for electrons in condensed matter systems, in particular in graphene, which is particularly amenable to these types of effects. Then, as another application of NV centers, more along the nano-MRI aspect, NV centers can be used to detect, ultimately, protein structure, either by directly imaging the nuclear spins — of course, this is still a bit of a ways off — or by imaging, say, electron spin labels that are easier to see and that have been labeled on a protein. And this is another — I won't talk about this, but this is something that's ongoing work in our group. And again, this slew of possible experiments that we're interested in, again, is a testament to the versatility and the compatibility of the NV center with biological samples and condensed matter samples over a wide range of temperatures. Now, I've mentioned this importance for a wide range of temperatures because if one wants to see some of these effects, for instance, these hydrodynamic flow effects in graphene, they exist at low temperature, as do many condensed matter phase transitions and phenomena. So it's important to go to cryogenic operation. And furthermore, in addition to offering the ability to see certain phenomena that only occur at low temperature, cryogenic operation also gives you an added sort of stability for free. Imaging with high spatial resolution at room temperature is down to sort of a few nanometer scale is very difficult because things drift over time. One other subtle thing that you'll see, I've slightly changed my diagram here. Now there's multiple probes, and I will just briefly say something about that. In our first experiments that I'll show you, we actually did use single crystal scanning probe cantilevers with and a whole array of tips. That's what's shown here in SEM image of one cantilever with an array of many diamond probes. Many of them have an NV center at the tip. One can see that by looking at a photoluminescence image of one of these toothbrushes. And the reason for this was manifold. One, although this was not planned in advance, but in hindsight, this type of structure allows you to do, say, wide field imaging simultaneously with high spatial resolution imaging. By imaging all of these on a camera, one can sort of span this wide dynamic range of spatial scales. And also, another thing that I want to point out is that this is something that's not highlighted in a lot of talks, and I won't highlight much in this talk, but it's also nice to have a few to choose from because not every pillar has an NV center inside of it. And in particular, going to low temperatures, and in particular for shallow NVs near the surface, they're not always 100%, as Vincent knows, in reality for these types of structures, are not always 100% photostable. And their properties can also degrade as a function of temperature that we've seen and other groups have seen and for unknown reasons. So this is another sort of advantage of having multiple probes on a tip. I just wanted to bring that up because I think it's useful to sort of be honest and understand the challenges that are facing the field and progress in the field. Okay, so our very first experiment at low temperature, as a proof of principle, was just to image a magnetic hard drive, which is a pretty large signal. And the reason I'm showing this image really quickly is just to show you our imaging technique, which is that of one of our imaging techniques, which is what I'll call contour imaging. So in order to take images more quickly, because NV imaging, I think, is still relatively slow compared to other imaging techniques, one can take an ODMR spectrum of the NV center once, and then fix your RF frequency at driving RF frequency at one point, and just monitor photoluminescence as a function of tip position, and just look at changes in the photoluminescence. So really, what you're imaging is you're imaging contours of constant magnetic field. And so, say, in this location where we see a dark spot, we know that the magnetic field is such that it brings the NV center into resonance with the microwaves. Now, and we're imaging in a bright spot here, we're off resonance. We don't know exactly what the field is, we just know that we're off resonance. And this allows us to image more quickly. So roughly in these initial images at low temperature, we're getting a sensitivity of a few microtesla per root hertz. One can also do what we call full field imaging, where at each point in the scan, one can take a full ESR spectrum and map out the magnetic field, in this case shown along the NV axis, but one can also extract from these images, as was mentioned earlier, the full vectorial range. This gives us higher dynamic range of the field, but a lower magnetic field sensitivity because it takes longer to take these images. So having demonstrated low temperature operation with a hard drive, which will look like a hard drive at room temperature and low temperature, we wanted to make sure, check compatibility and begin to look at some interesting low temperature condensed matter systems. In this case, we looked at, we took an NV center to image vortices in a high temperature superconductor, in this case an iron pnictide superconductor, which was field cooled in a field of 10 Gauss to trap vortices. The field was turned off for the measurement. And again, we're taking a contour image here, so we're fixing the frequency of our microwave drive. And where there are dark lines or dark spots, that's where the magnetic field at the location of the NV center corresponds to, in this case, about 6 Gauss. So the nice thing here was we were able to actually use the NV center in a low temperature system and maintain the properties of the expected properties of the superconductor. I think Patrick might talk about similar experiments, but right around the same time, Patrick's group also had done similar imaging of superconductors at low temperature. And I just want to acknowledge that the samples were grown by Nini's group at UCLA. So I'll just briefly, before I get into the conductivity imaging, which I'll spend a little more time on, I just briefly wanted to also mention some of the work in our group ongoing and also imaging skirmions, which I thankfully can blow through my talk because Vincent has introduced many of the concepts involved. And again, these skirmions are these non-trivial magnetic textures that exist in materials with certain competing interactions, in particular Agel-Shinsky-Maria interaction. And the end result is that one gets these vortex-like spin excitations that enjoy topological protection. Their size can vary from nanometers to microns. And with the many advanced techniques that have been developed to study skirmions, and with their sort of excitement for spintronics applications, it's we recognize that local nanoscale probing is important in order to study the internal spin structure, as well as look at dynamics on small scales, as well as study disorder, which I will also highlight. We have done some work on determining the internal spin structure of these skirmions. I'm only going to focus on what I think is one of the more unique utilities of the NV center, and that in looking at the disorder. So in this experiment, we took an NV center and we imaged a magnetic multilayer, which was again grown by a different group, in this case the Kang Wang's group at UCLA. At zero field, in this material with perpendicular magnetic anisotropy, you expect to see a stripe-like magnetic phase, which we see. As we increase the magnetic field, we enter the regime of the skirmion phase. And this is, again, a contour image. We're imaging contours of magnetic field. But clearly, one can see that in this case, the skirmions are not all round. They are, and they're not all the same. And so this was an indication that most likely the material, as Vincent also mentioned, is likely contains some disorder. In addition to their structure not being sort of round and periodic in space, we also found that temporally these skirmions are not stable as well. So in addition to this deviation from circular, we see that the skirmions exhibit some kind of domain wall jumping. So you can see here is one contour of a skirmion, and then you see this faint line here, which is indication of the domain wall jumping in time from one place to another, spending less time here where it's sort of fainter and more time in this area where it's darker. And we've started to look at the time scale of these dynamics, and that's sort of ongoing work in our group. Yes, so that's, so one can do, and I don't know if I have a full field image. One cannot tell that from these contour images, because really these contour images can only tell you when the field in this case is 5 Gauss, okay? And so when you're inside here, the field is presumably larger. When the field is out here, the field is smaller. If you were to do a full field image, yes, you can. And we can do those, they just take longer. And for the purposes of what we wanted to do, they weren't, in this case, for looking at disorder and looking at domain while jumping, it wasn't necessary. Okay, so for the rest of the imaging part of the talk, I wanted to talk about using the NV center in another modality, that of relaxation imaging, which was introduced also in the last talk, in particular to image the electrical conductivity of materials with high spatial resolution. So we have seen that in the presence of a DC magnetic field or a coherent AC magnetic field, the ODMR spectrum or the spin levels of the NV center move in sort of a coherent, predictable way. In the presence of magnetic noise, schematically shown here, so schematically shown here is sort of the power spectral density of some magnetic noise, which could originate from many different sources. In the presence of this noise, which might come from fluctuating spins or currents or magnetic systems such as spin waves or other material systems near a transition temperature, magnetic noise will exist. And what that does to the NV center is it relaxes the NV center. It increases the relaxation rate between the ms equals 0 and ms equals minus 1, or ms equals 0 and ms equals plus 1 levels. So in effect, the NV center is acting as a sort of spectrometer of the magnetic field noise, where the NV center is sensitive to magnetic field fluctuations at the frequency that's set by the splitting between either these two levels or these two levels. And in that way, it can sort of spectroscopically resolve these noise fluctuations. And what I'll talk about, we sort of assume that the noise is flat because it generally is for conducting samples at low frequency. So in our experiment, what we did is we took, again, diamond pillars. In this case, the problem's a little bit inverted. We put the sample on the scanning probe, and in this case, our NV centers are in a bulk piece of diamond with pillars fabricated on it, but really it's the same thing. We're scanning the NV center with respect to the sample. We took a metal film that was either thin and uniform or patterned into small structures. Now, if you bring a metallic film next to an NV center, what's going to happen? Well, there's Johnson noise, and this was presented in the last talk as well. This, in a non-imaging sense, in a sensing sense, this was introduced or first published a few years ago in Misha Lukin's group. But the presence of this Johnson or thermal motion in a metal introduces magnetic field noise, which has a spectral component at the transition frequency from the 0 to, say, the minus 1 and the 0 to the plus 1 state. And one can calculate what that what the power spectrum of those magnetic field fluctuations is by using the Biot-Savart law. And if one does that, one finds that this power spectrum is related to the conductivity of the material in this way, and also on the separation of your NV center to the film, as well as the thickness of the film. So if the film is really 2D or 3D, you'll see these have the 1 over D squared over 1 over D dependence. So these magnetic fluctuations induce relaxation of the NV center. And how do we measure that? Well, in this plot here, what I show you is a T1 curve where we initialize the NV center into one of its states, in this case the zero state, and just wait for some time in the dark and see how does the spin state relax to a thermal distribution. In the absence of any metal nearby, when the NV center is far away from any metal, we see that the bare NV spin relaxation is on the order of 5 milliseconds. When we bring the NV center near to a silver film, we find that the relaxation is reduced when we're about 100 nanometers away by about a factor of 5. Now what we can do is we can now, instead of taking an image at one point, we can scan the NV center over in this case, a nano-patterned silver sample, where these are 400 by 400 nanometer and 85 nanometer thick pads of aluminum, and measure the T1 as a function of position, and from this make a T1 image where the T1 is reduced when we're close to the metal because of the local conductivity of the sample. Now, one can also be quantitative. Instead of just showing, OK, the T1 is reduced, one can actually quantitatively measure the conductivity by, let's say, at each point, one can take what we'll call a Z-scan, where we measure the relaxation rate of the NV as a function of distance between it and the metal film. Such a plot is shown here, in this case, for a silver film. And again, fitting the data to this expected functional form, one can extract this conductivity sigma. And in fact, we did that for three different metals, silver, aluminum, and we also did this for gold. It's not plotted here. And from that, we can extract quantitatively the conductivity of these different materials and find them to be in good agreement, not with bulk values, because the conductivity is suppressed for thin films, but in fact, in good agreement with what one would expect and with transport measurements of thin film values. So just want to stress that. So this, I think, adds another element to the multimodality of the NV center as a local quantitative, non-invasive, and nanoscale probe of conductivity. This combination, I think, is pretty unique in terms of other conductivity probes that exist, such as microwave impedance microscopy or conducting AFM, which is more invasive. And really, I think one of the big advantages here is that our signal is not really convolved with some interaction of the tip with the sample. It's really, again, just a single spin and looking at the fluctuations of the material. Yes. This is 20, and this is 15. Yeah, so this is, but it's still pretty small, and I am fully on board with what Vincent has mentioned about the importance of the distance of the NV center to the material, and we also oftentimes see distances that are larger than we expect. In these cases, we couldn't get that close. In this case, we could. We believe this for a variety of reasons, also through our photoluminescence quenching measurement. Everything sort of makes sense. There's no exact way to measure it, but everything's kind of consistent with this actually being that point of closest separation. We suspect the angular misalignment between our probes is is the dominant factor, and there might be, you know, there could also be other, because these were different samples, right? And so they had the tilt had to change. So in this case, the distances are extracted from this curve. Yes.
So
yes, the fit gives us sigma, and it gives us d, and t film we know, so we can measure that independently. But yes, and in fact, yes, and in fact, you sort of have to use this full form. You can't assume sort of a 2D or a 3D geometry, which, if you had a 3D geometry, as I said, there would be this 1 over d dependence or a 1 over d squared for 2D geometry. In fact, I think this is kind of neat because it can also tell you something about the dimensionality of the conductivity in your sample. It can differentiate between 2D and 3D conductivity as well, which I think for like topological insulation would be cool. Yeah. I think, so is your question, can we resolve in spatial resolution or can we? So what sort of, how narrow are you for, like? Well, that's sort of the, yeah, so the idea is, so that's sort of the hope. I mean, it's going to be limited by the spatial resolution, which is going to be limited by the separation of our NV center to the sample, which, you know, depending on how close you can get, ideally we think we should be able to get to 10 nanometers. We've shown we can get to about 15 nanometers. So, so we can resolve conductivity features on the order of our separation. I'll show, actually I think I'm not showing that plot here, but we've shown that we can resolve conductivity variations in the sample up to the distance from of our tip to our sample. So depending on sort of the width of your channels or the effective width, then yes. Yes. Yeah, so plasmonic effects in terms of, yes. So for instance, plasmonic effects could lead to, okay, so what are some of the things that could happen? Quenching is one, right? So some non-radiative energy transfer. And we do see that. But that's all normalized out of these experiments. The way we do our measurements, we project both onto the zero state and the one state and can correct for photoluminescence changes throughout the scan, which are significant in this case. And so just thinking sort of at the next step, what could this be used for? I think there's a lot of interesting systems. One that we have sort of done some simulations for, there's many materials, in particular in the complex oxides, that go through metal insulator phase transitions. And oftentimes at that transition, one gets phase separation, nanoscale phase separation between metallic and insulating pockets. And so what we just did is we simulated, in this case, a one-dimensional line scan of what our signal would look like if we scanned our NV center over these approximately, I think these are supposed to be 40 or 50 nanometer pockets separated, in this case, by 10 nanometer gap. And importantly, this 10 nanometer insulating gap is resolvable in this measurement. And I should say that the parameters that we used for the simulation, so this simulation includes an averaging of 1 minute per point, which is still significant. In fact, T1 imaging is time intensive just because T1s are quite long. But I will say that one important advance that we think we added to the imaging was that in using spin to charge conversion readout techniques, we realized a 25-fold reduction in imaging time in our experiments, and also have been put into the simulation along with other very realistic experimental parameters that were actually realized in the experiment. So I think there could be some exciting future directions for conductivity imaging. Okay, and then I'll just briefly for, how many minutes do I have? Okay, good. So I think I'll be great then. Okay, so so just moving on to a sort of very different topic of hybrid spin mechanical systems. Our group has been interested for some time in coupling NV centers to mechanical degrees of freedom. Many of the reasons were, again, highlighted in Peter's talk yesterday, but really the driving interest of us in our research is using mechanical or phononic systems to control and read out qubit systems, and as well as acting as a means of quantum transduction or mediating quantum information between, say, remote and even disparate qubits. This schematic shows here the utility of mechanical resonators in a hybrid quantum network, in particular sensitivity to many different fields and degrees of freedom, which will allow them to interface to, say, photons through radiation pressure forces, to spin qubits through magnetic forces if one functionalizes a cantilever with something magnetic, to charge qubits if one functionalizes the cantilever with something charged, and also through a strain-mediated coupling in which an NV center can interact with the motion of the cantilever through the strain induced by the cantilever's motion. And in fact, largely for the reason that Dan Ruger also brought up, I think in Peter's talk yesterday, we focused on embedded qubits where NV centers couple to the mechanical degree of freedom through an intrinsic strain mechanism, because this eliminates the need for positioning a mechanical resonator nearby to any surface or to, say, the spin qubit or charge qubit that you want to couple to, which typically induces a lot of both decoherence of the spin and also of the resonator. And there's also, this is just a much more simpler approach because one doesn't have to position things to begin with. Okay, so now, if one wants to think about this coupling in the quantum regime, there's really one important quantity, which is the quantum cooperativity, eta, which relates the coupling strength to g squared, in this case, the coupling strength squared, to the product of the relevant decay mechanisms, the mechanical decoherence rate, as well as the NV decoherence rate. Okay. And so it's important for this to be, you know, for most applications, larger than one. Our group, as well as Patrick Militinsky's and Marcus Doherty's group over the last few years, has done several NV measurements inside of mechanical oscillators to measure these coupling strengths, both in the ground state and in the excited state, in order to allow us to put a number on, you know, where we are and what our prospects are for single spin cooperativity. So given the numbers that we have measured, if one, say, optimizes some simplistic mechanical device, in this case a doubly clamped beam, optimizes for this coupling strength, which the coupling strength will go as 1 over L square root of L cubed times the width. Basically, you want very small mechanical devices to reach the quantum regime. It kind of makes sense. Usually for quantum things, you want to go small. But in these sort of optimized devices, the coupling strengths are, I should have written this down, is the ground state coupling is a kilohertz. The excited state coupling, however, is about 5 orders of magnitude higher, so that has some exciting prospects. Now, if we take these numbers and plug them into the ground state and the excited state at pretty aggressive parameters in the ground state of 1 Kelvin temperature, 100 millisecond T2, and very high quality factors, one can only barely get to this quantum regime. So as was pointed out yesterday, this looks, I'm not completely hopeless, but it looks difficult. The excited state, as I said, you win by a lot, so we can relax our parameters here to something that we can actually achieve and currently in our experiments, which is 4 Kelvin. We can assume optical relaxation rate of about 100 megahertz and a lower Q factor of 10 to the fifth, and one should be able to get to the quantum regime. But still, these numbers are not high, and I should say that they're in particular a bit challenging to reach, because if we look at these numbers, for T2 is quite optimistic and quite high Qs, and also for this radiative, for the excited state relaxation rate, these are hard. And why are these in particular hard? Because this type of doubly clamped geometry is small. And when NV centers, so in a small device, the NV centers necessarily have to be near the surfaces. Then these numbers start getting bad, as people have seen. And furthermore, for these very small devices, clamping losses, mechanical clamping losses, become quite significant. And these Qs are really what are the clamping loss limited Qs. In fact, we kind of optimize these devices to predict clamping losses as well. But in any case, these are still tough. So, as I mentioned, clamping losses increase for small length, and we want small lengths to have higher coupling, and T2 and also gamma. T2 reduces, gamma increases near the surface. So thinking about some more exotic geometries beyond just simply doubly clamped beams, we've been thinking about what are other mechanical resonator geometries that will allow us to avoid these problems of increased clamping loss and NV property degradation near surfaces. So some solutions could be to go to surface acoustic wave, and eventually surface acoustic wave resonators, and one-dimensional optomechanical crystals. So I'm not really going to talk much about the surface acoustic waves, just because we have settled, at least currently, on these 1D optomechanical crystals. And so what these, these are effectively photonic and phononic cavities. For the purposes of the mechanics, one can just think of as a phononic cavity, where the piercing of the holes at some lattice spacing produces a band gap for mechanical excitations, and also a localized phononic mode. Importantly, what is happening here is the clamps for this resonator are formed right here, and they're far away from the actual clamps of the device. So this is sort of protection from clamping losses. Another nice advantage here is that these can be made very high frequency because of their small size. Okay, so we've made these structures in diamond. Here is an example. This is an SEM image of one of these structures. There's actually two of them on the chip. One can couple to these and measure the mechanics through typical standard optomechanical techniques using a photonic waveguide here. This is a phononic shield to provide extra mechanical insulation, isolation from phonon leakage. And so our first measurements of these devices, which I should mention, we had a lot of help with collaborations with Amir Safafi-Naini and Alison Rugar. You might recognize the last name. Yes, it was Dan's daughter who worked in our lab for a summer. Unfortunately, she went to Stanford, so I'm still unhappy about that. But no. So we made these devices. We characterized their optical properties. This just shows a resonance curve of the these are made at 1550 nanometers. In this case, that's where we're using to read out the mechanics for simplicity and for compatibility with 1550 nanometer. Developed optics. The Qs, optical Qs, are 40,000, which is we're very happy with. Mechanical Qs were significantly lower than we thought, especially odd given that the optical Qs were this high. Usually when the optical Qs are high, the mechanical Qs are also high. We don't totally understand this, but we're on our second round of devices, and we think this should, we don't think there's any reason why this should be low. These measurements were also taken at room temperature and air, and the next steps too would be to put them in our fridge. So another important thing is that these devices still maintain, their NV centers still exist inside of them. So here's a confocal photoluminescence image, as well as an optically detected magnetic resonance signal showing that hyperfine is still resolvable. I should mention that the NV centers, so these are 200 nanometers thick, the NV centers lie in the middle of the structure, 100 nanometers below the surface and above the bottom surface. Again, that was one of the motivations for going to these structures, as opposed to doubly clamped or singly clamped beams, where your strain is really maximized at the top or the bottom surface. In these cases, this mode has a uniform strain profile across the cross-section of the device, and hence we can sort of maximally protect our NV centers from surfaces by sticking them right in the middle of the device. And hence, the in this case, the spin properties are still good, and in going to low temperature, we can measure the optical properties. So that basically summarizes where we are. There's not much to show in the sort of the quantum regime of coupling there, but these has sort of taken, these are some lengthy steps involved. So just to summarize, I showed you that the NV center is a versatile quantum probe capable of imaging nanoscale magnetic textures and conductivity. By the way, this was this full field skirmion image. I think Chris was asking about that earlier. And one can see here the field varies. And this is our conductivity imaging, and we're sort of marching towards the quantum regime of coupling with some new geometries with considering the actual effects on the NV centers for quantum coupling. So thank you very much. No, because these are 1550 nanometer cavities. So the optical, so in this case, the optics is just there purely for, well, yeah, for driving and for readout, because, right, it's hard to actuate these. These are six gigahertz mechanical resonance. So that can be done, but then your mechanical frequencies become really high. So your spacing of your hole sets both the optical and the mechanical frequencies. And so that would make the mechanical frequencies quite a bit higher, which, okay, one would just need sort of higher frequency electronics. It's not impossible, but for starters, we like the idea of being in 3 gigahertz near the NV transition frequency, and that matching the sort of 1550 nanometer. So that's, yeah, where we are now. The cooperativity we expect on these devices at low temperature are similar to the cooperativities that I showed, so on the order of a few, but we expect the ability to reach the actual parameters needed to get to those cooperativities will be much more realistic. So that's really sort of the motivation for these. Okay,
so
yes.
As far as I understand, the pattern is always square.
Yes.
And on the image, it looks like circular.
Yeah, so that's, I mean, so it's, again, I mean, it is, you know, we have sort of some kind of point spread function, right? So when we're imaging here, say, we're a bit sort of closer to, in between the walls, we're sort of closer to two conducting islands, I guess, and we're sort of sensing conductivity in a volume. In these cases, I think we're 40 nanometers away for these images. So we kind of have like a 40 nanometer area over which we're scanning. That's one reason. I mean, there's also potentially some interesting things going on at the edges, because the conductivity is slightly suppressed at the edges, and not purely just for, you know, the reduction, you know, simplistic reduction of mean free path, which will reduce the conductivity. But there are some expected edge effects, and we were hoping that we could sort of figure out if we can measure some of those. For instance, you know, the conductivity is going to be anisotropic, right, at the edge. You're going to have a higher conductivity along the edge than across it. And then our NV center can, in principle, measure the different directions of conductivity. But yeah, at this point, I think it's mostly just proximity to the other metallic things.
Persistent.
So my postdoc was on persistent currents, but it but that was so okay. So I but I'm thinking of persistent currents that are due to like a quantum coherent effect, which happens. So there you need, you know, in order for those effects to be visible, you need to have your phase coherence length to be comparable to sort of the length of you know of your path, your ring path, I guess. And that's very temperature dependent. You know, that has it's you have to go to sort of sub Kelvin in order to get micron scale long phase coherence length. So I don't expect that, at least that sort of sense of persistent currents to be interesting. But I think, you know, maybe at low temperatures that could be anything to look at. Oh, in the diamond. So so we have done some experiments several years ago where we actually looked very carefully at the coherence time of the NB center as a function of depth below the surface. And basically we saw that it's around 20 nanometers where the coherence time really takes a dip. So below 20 nanometers, your coherence time drops from orders of hundreds of microseconds, and it starts dropping down to, say, 5-10 microseconds. So at 100 nanometers, we expect to be clearly in the bulk, in the bulk regime, basically, is what we found. And that can be generally for us, we use delta doping with CVD growth, and our coherence temperatures are reproducibly in the hundreds of microseconds to millisecond range. So that's what we expect. So at low temperature, yeah. So at room temperature, we're limited by the T1, which is several milliseconds as well. But at low temperature, presumably, we should be able to, other people have demonstrated in the bulk, not near the surface. I think that's actually a really interesting experiment to do, is look at extension of coherence times as a function of temperature near surfaces. The hope would be to go up to hundreds of milliseconds.